So hopefully you have an umbrella. Hopefully you don't mind seeing winged creatures coming after you. So we're going to have a good time today. My name is Catherine Simpson. I'm a senior communications and marketing major at Wright State University in Dayton, Ohio. Anyone know where that is? Yay! Oh, great! Awesome. I'm actually from Gallipolis, Ohio, which is just right over the river. But all of my family is from Point Pleasant. My uncle is Jeff Walmsley, the curator of the Mothman Museum, as well as the originator of the Mothman Festival. So I feel like I'm a little bit qualified to be leading this tour today. This is my friend Elmer. I'm going to say hi, Elmer.
Hi, Elmer.
He's going to be giving us some tips and facts and stuff that I won't be able to tell you. And this is our driver, Terry. I'm going to say hi, Terry.
Hi, Terry.
This is Terry. He's our driver. He's awesome. So we're going to be heading on out to the TNT area, but before we do so, we're going to give you some information about what the TNT area is, why it's important, and who the heck is Mothman. So, does anyone know why the date November 15th, 1966 is important?
Yes.
Not the Silver Bridge. Anything else? Anyone?
First sighting,
correct. I don't have any candy, but congrats. So November 15th, 1966, the first sighting of the Mothman. Does anyone know who first sighted the Mothman?
Richard Gere.
That is the first time we've heard that. No, it's not Richard Gere. We're going to be making some jokes about Richard Gere a little bit later. Does anyone know? No, it is Barry actually was one of the people, but it's Linda and Roger Scarberry, and Mary and Steve Mallett. So yes, you are kind of correct. So these two couples, Roger and Linda and Mary and Steve, were out in the TNT area. As you can see, this area of Point Pleasant is just a booming metropolis of things to do. It's not. So in the 60s, as you can imagine, there wasn't a whole lot going on, not a whole lot to do. So they had to make their own fun. Some of that fun consisted of going out to the TNT area, doing a little thing called parking, in case you guys have ever heard of that or ever done it. I'm sure none of you have ever done that. None of you. So they would go out to the TNT area, park, they would go drag racing. We're going to show you a little straight stretch out of the TNT area that is perfect for drag racing. They do all kinds of stuff out there. So they're out in the TNT area, driving around in Roger's Chevy Bel Air, and Linda is in the back seat, and she's just looking around, you know, they're having a good time, and she looks out the window towards the North Power Plant, and she sees a figure, like a dark figure, coming out of the power plant. She's not really sure what it is, she thought it was probably a bird or something, but then she sees these glowing red eyes, and she's like, that's probably not a bird. That cannot be a bird. So everyone else looks and sees this creature, and they realize that they are in the wrong place at the wrong time. So they're booking it out of there because this creature is chasing them. So they're on their way out of the TNT area, which we're going to be going into, and I'll show you which roads they were driving on. They're driving out of the TNT area at about 105, 106 miles an hour, and this creature is keeping up with them the whole way. It's right over their car. It's flapping its wings, scraping the top of the car, making dents in the side of the car. And for all those that know Roger or knew Roger, he loved his car. So for someone to be attacking his car in such a way, creating dents, not an okay thing, but he's not about to tell them not to at this point. He's just trying to get away. So they're driving away, and they come near a field with a white picket fence. In order to point it out to you, it actually still is here, and this is where he disappeared. So they're driving, and all of a sudden, he's just gone. So they continue to drive a little ways down to Tiny's Drive-In, which is now Village Pizza. I don't know how many of you are from Point Pleasant or know of Village Pizza, but it is up here on the right. We will point it out. So they drive up to Village Pizza and see their friend Gary, and they're like, hey, Gary, we just saw something kind of crazy. So Gary and some police officers go with these two couples back towards the direction in which they saw this creature, hoping to see it again, hoping to find out what had just happened. So they're on their way back, and they pass the same field in which they saw the creature disappear the first time, and Linda and the other two, or other three with her, this initially saw Mothman, see him again for just a moment, and in just enough time in which they could say, hey, look, it's there again, it was gone, and Gary and the police officers did not see the creature. They did, however, believe that these four had seen something, they just didn't know what. So they took them back to the police station, put them in four different rooms, and had them each give their own eyewitness account of what had just happened to them. They did this so in case the four of them had, like, created a hoax, or they were, had, you know, talked beforehand to create their stories, you know, make their stories the same. They put them in four separate rooms, hoping that they could get some accurate accounts. And what they ended up with was four very, very similar stories with similar timelines, similar features. Chronologically, these stories matched up perfectly. Some other key features and points in the story that matched up were the speed at which they left the TNT area, 105 to 106 miles an hour, and also the account of the glowing red eyes. There are other features in the story that match up. You can actually read these eyewitness accounts in the World's Only Mothman Museum. They are the first thing you see when you walk in, and they have the original documents. They also have them reprinted, so if you want to be able to read them a little bit better. So I highly suggest that you do that. So that is the first eyewitness account of anyone that has ever seen Mothman. And Elmer's going to tell you a little bit about a similar story that happened during the same week.
During this time, does anybody know what a UFO flap is?
Yes.
Well, let me tell you what a UFO flap is. Usually, basically what a UFO flap is a bunch of UFO sightings within a period of months or a year. So, lo and behold, a few weeks beforehand, during a few weeks before, there was a man who's heard his dog carrying on outside, and he's goes outside. Has anybody ever seen the movie Close Encounters of the Third Kind? Alright there is Tiny's, aka Village Pizza. Best pizza around here. If you get hungry later on, there's a Mothman pizza. It's really, really good, trust me. So back to our story at hand. So in Salem, West Virginia, about 50 to 100 miles away from here, this man heard his dog carrying on outside. So he walks outside to see what the commotion is about. Well, he looks up and he sees bright lights in the sky. So, you know, he's trying to get his dog to get in the house, but his dog wasn't having it, so it takes off, and he never finds his dog again. Well, a few weeks later, lo and behold, you know, we had the Mothman sightings up this way, and whenever they were speeding through, they thought they had actually lost the Mothman at one point, and they actually seen the creature beside the road circling this dog. Well, you know, obviously they didn't know who the dog was or anything like that. Obviously they weren't thinking about that. So later on, whenever the police came back out here to check everything out, they actually saw the dog that they were talking about in the report, and they did a little background check on him because he had a collar on, and lo and behold, it was the farmer's dog that was missing for a few weeks beforehand that mysteriously got here from 100 miles away. So it's kind of a scary thought that, you know, this dog just appeared here just out of left field. So
spooky stuff, right? That it all matches up. So I'm going to give you guys a little bit of information about the TNT area and what it was used for. Does anyone have any idea of what the TNT area was used for? Might have something to do with TNT. So the TNT area, otherwise known as the North Power Plant, manufactured ammunition, dynamite, stuff like that during the efforts for World War II. It was opened in 1942, closed about 3 years later. They didn't need as much dynamite, I guess, as they thought they did. So it's now a wildlife refuge. It's called the McClintock Wildlife Refuge. So they did, like I said, they made ammunition, dynamite, all kinds of stuff. So this area is believed to be a little bit toxic. Every couple of months, they actually come in and test the soil, make sure it's safe for people living in this area. I think it's safe. We're not really sure. No one really knows. So some people believe that maybe Mothman could have been some type of animal or even some type of human that got out in this area for too long or got toxins in its body. It mutated a little bit from being in the TNT area. Some other people have different beliefs. Some people believe he was just a bird, a very large bird that had some weird eyes. He could be an alien. Lots of different things. I want to tell you guys a little theory that I have, and that's the idea that Mothman could be a spiritual entity. So when we talk about the TNT area, back in the 60s and even today, and especially in the 80s, the TNT area was a hub for satanic worship. It still kind of is, like I said. I'll should tell you a little story. So my mom grew up in this area, and in 1986, I believe, she snuck out of the house and decided her and her friends were going to go up to the TNT area, and, you know, I think she told me last night that they used to, like, play hide-and-go-seek out here. I don't know what they were thinking, but they were out in this area late at night, and they went into one of these igloos that we are actually going to go into today. I'm not sure if it's a specific igloo, but they went into one of these igloos, and they saw a sacrifice. It wasn't a human, it was a cat, but still, they got out of there pretty quickly. So that just gives you an example of this area is public property. Anyone can go up there, and a lot of people use it for different types of rituals. Some people use it for illegal things. We're not going to talk about that. But this idea that Mothman could possibly be a spiritual entity has three different components to it, in my opinion. And I'm going to throw out some terms at you guys. Is anyone familiar with Greek mythology?
Yes.
Yes? You guys ever heard of a Nephilim or a Nephilim? Yes? Anyone say yes? So, a Nephilim or a Nephilim, I've heard different pronunciations, is a cross between a woman and a fallen demonic angel. It creates a man with wings. In all of our modern culture, Mothman has been depicted as a man with wings, or a creature with wings, you know, in a man-like figure. So that's one. It's also referenced in the book of Genesis before the flood, and I also heard yesterday that it is pre-Adam and Eve. It's been referenced in literature. Number two, it doesn't actually have a name, but it does have a description. I'm going to describe it to you, and you can tell me what you think it sounds like. A round sphere, round object with eyes lining the outside, and it has legs that extend down and revolve. What does that sound like? Anyone? To me, it kind of sounds like a UFO. Eyes on the outside, circling around with legs that extend down. Those are referenced in the book of Ezekiel. And then the third one is just described as a male demonic figure. And how that ties into our story is the Men in Black. So, have you guys ever heard of the Men in Black? Yes. So the Men in Black arrived in Point Pleasant, West Virginia, not too long after the first sighting of the Mothman. As you know, they wore black suits, black hats, black glasses. Pretty cold people. I also have heard different eyewitness accounts, and I read this in the museum, that anyone that came near Men in Black said they smelled of sulfur. They smelled, you know, they didn't smell great. When I think sulfur, I think brimstone, fire and brimstone, you know, hell, death, things like that. So, here's sewage. Here's an example involving Linda Scarberry of how those could be spiritual entities. Linda Scarberry, at a time after her, a couple years after, she had a daughter, and she befriended John Keel, who was the author of the Mothman Prophecies. He was in this area a lot, doing research, trying to see the Mothman. And she expressed fears of being scared for her daughter. So John Keel said, you should just put a crucifix in your room. You might feel a little bit better at night. So one night, after she had already placed a crucifix in her room, Linda wakes to a man at the end of her bed. And no, it's not Mothman. It was a Men in Black. And he's just standing there, and he goes to light a cigarette. So he pulls out this match, he goes to light the cigarette, and as he lights this match to light the cigarette, the light bounces off of the crucifix and bounces back, and she claims that he disappeared. So, that's a little creepy, a little spiritual. So, when you put all those three things together, it's very, very likely that Mothman could have been a spiritual entity. Just an opinion. Everyone has a lot of different opinions. Elmer's going to share some of his a little bit later. So we just want to give you guys all the different theories that we've heard over time, just so you can make your own conclusions about what you feel Mothman could or might be. So we have now arrived in the TNT area. As you can see, there is a lot of foliage out here. It's all going to be really grown up. You're not going to be able to see the igloos or aqueducts really from the road unless you look really, really hard at the right side of the window. If you see one, holler, we'll look for it. So once we get up here, we are going to be getting off of the bus. Like I said, you're not required to get off the bus if you do not want to. I know it is a little bit rainy. It looks like it stopped a little bit, so if you have an umbrella, bring it with you. I will tell you that on the inside of these igloos, it is very cold. and it is very dark. So if you have a flashlight or a phone with you that has a flashlight, I recommend you bring it with you. Just so when you get in, you can give yourself some time, your eyes to adjust, and you can see, watch your step when you get in. And it is going to be very loud in there. The walls of these igloos are very thick concrete. The sound bounces off like crazy. So I'm just going to be giving you guys some facts once we get in there. If you can't hear him out there, you're probably talking too loud. So just listen to him. He'll give you some info. If you have any questions, I know he'll answer them. I'm also going to tell you guys what these igloos are. Does anyone have any idea? And no, they're not Eskimo igloos. Yes, they were. They're used to store ammunition. Perfect. So these igloos are designed the way they are, with a dome shape with a hole in the top. The hole in the top is so if there's for ventilation, and also if there's ever an explosion, the explosion will go up instead of out, cause a little bit less damage. So you're going to see all that once you get in there. Do watch your step. I know there is broken glass. Like I said, people like to come up here and do things they shouldn't do. If you'd like to leave your things on the bus, you're more than welcome to. Our driver Terry's going to be on the bus at all times. Make sure you take small children and your husbands by the hand. We don't want anyone to get lost. It's definitely safe, I promise. If it wasn't safe, I'd probably be radioactive at this point. You would know. We were out there a couple times yesterday. We did do a tour last night at 10 p.m., and there were probably 15 cars up here in addition to our tour bus. It was a little bit busy. Hopefully we don't scare these people when we show up. Or maybe we do. All right, we are here.
Don't go to Lover's Lane. Don't ignore the buzz on the television. Before the flying night. He sends premonition. Does he live on the canal or in the platform munitions? Did he destroy the silver bridge or save the citizen? Point by sound, we live beneath the shadow of days and numbered one and all. There's no rest here between the mountains and the meadow. We know it's supernatural. Oh no! And watch out, the Mothman will steal you away.
How many igloos are there?
From
From what I know of, there's probably more. I know at least 200, 250 for myself. There's probably more than that. They actually say that the people who made out here also helped make Area 51, because there are rumors of underground tunnels here. The reason why they'd be underground tunnels for if the North Power Plant got attacked, they could actually go underground, and that way they're protected. Now, the thing is, most people don't realize, notice how much, you know, brush and stuff around these things. The reason why that is to keep it camouflaged from, you know, anybody going over and bombing the place at the time. We was number two on the hit list for World War II. I think in this area here, I think we was number five during 9/11 because of the chemical plants and stuff up and down the Ohio River and the Arbor River. So, you know, the 9/11, I think the one that hit the Pentagon actually went over this area here. So, you know, it has significant history to it. You know, most people think, oh, well, this is Mothman. Well, not really, because they have had some very deep history. You know, obviously, Cornstalk, you know, the Battle of Point Pleasant, the Revolutionary War, you know, all this stuff, you know, it's connected to wars as well. Just, you know, obviously Mothman. This town right here has a lot of rich history, and you know, it's a beautiful town. I love it. You know, I hope you guys love it too, because it has just that heart and soul that most people, you know, just miss these days. Because you know, you meet these people out on the street, they talk to you, they don't even know who you are. You know. So, anybody have any other questions? All right.
Have all the bunkers like been searched through since like recently? So no. They could still be like stuff in them from like the 60s and stuff?
Oh yeah, there's still, if you look over here on the wall line here, there's still canisters right here. So there's still stuff in here from the 60s, from the 40s, you know. It's just one of those things that they haven't probably been opened up because, you know, after a while they don't really care, you know what I mean? Any other questions? I'll let you guys have another 1 minute right here. Get back to the bus.
Promise the tour is not over. We're going to talk about some other stuff that's significant to the Mothman and all of his sightings. Someone was telling me earlier that when they were out here another time, they saw a crane. I'm going to tell an interesting story and theory about a specific type of crane in this area that people believe could have been what someone and witnesses had sighted. Has anyone ever heard of a sandhill crane?
Yes.
Yeah, okay, here it goes. So a sandhill crane is a crane indigenous to this area. They stand about 3 to 5 feet tall. They do have white feathers, long neck, long legs, like a crane. And they do have an interesting patch of feathers that are red, and they are located on their forehead that kind of like dip over their eyes. So a WVU professor in a documentary I watched called Eyes of the Mothman talked about how some eyewitnesses could have seen this type of bird in this area. And when I was up here a couple months ago, doing research for these tours, I actually saw a sandhill crane in one of these ponds up here. So we'll see. We'll go by kind of slow, see if we can see one. If not, we didn't see any at all yesterday. I promise I'm telling the truth. I promise they're here. So we'll see if we can see one up here. It's right up here in this little opening, so look to your right, and we'll see if we can see any cranes or critters out there. Looks like just a lot of ducks. Well, that's a bummer. If you guys ever come up here, check in the water areas, you'll definitely see a lot of birds. Some that might look like Mothman. So another thing that we need to talk about when talking about Mothman and what he's done for this area is I'm going to give you guys another date. We're going to see if you can guess what happened on that date. December 15th, 1967. Yes, it was the bridge. The bridge, Silver Bridge Collapse, was depicted in a movie called The Mothman Prophecies, starring Richard Gere and Laura Linney. I know we talked about that earlier. You guys love Richard Gere. So, does anyone know where that movie was filmed? Pittsburgh is half correct, but there's another town that housed the bridge that looked just like the Silver Bridge in Point Pleasant. Catan? Ooh, who knew that? That's awesome. Catanning, Pennsylvania. So yeah, I think Catanning's about an hour out of Pittsburgh. I think the reason they filmed there is just because they had a large crew, and I don't think Richard Gere really wanted to stay at the historic haunted Lowe Hotel. I kind of wish he would have. It would have made for a whole other movie. Would have been awesome. So, some fun facts about that movie. Like I said, filmed in Catanning and Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. One interesting fact that I think is something weird is in the movie they say that 36 people perished in the Silver Bridge tragedy, but in actuality 46 people perished. Yesterday I actually didn't know the reason, but someone on our very last tour told me the reason why they used the number 36. Apparently the director of the movie, his father's lucky number was 36, so they used the number 36. I don't know if that's true, but I thought that was an interesting fact. I was like, wow, how do you know that? So we're going to keep going with that. But in actuality, 46 people did perish in the Silver Bridge tragedy. Like I said, December 15th, 1967, it's exactly 13 months to the day after the first sighting of Mothman, which was on November 15th, 1966. So 13, number 13 has some significance here. It was also the 13th eye bar of the bridge that caused the collapse. Spooky. Some people believe to have seen Mothman sitting upon the 13th eye bar before the collapse of the bridge. Some people have also said that they saw Mothman trying to hold the bridge up before the collapse. Just depends on your view of Mothman, if you think he's a good guy or a bad guy. It was also very close to Christmas. A lady we had on a tour yesterday gave me a really cool story. Apparently, she was a child in 1966, living in Parkersburg, West Virginia, and she remembers watching WSAZ and seeing an image that they had filmed, and it was just an image of Christmas presents floating in the river. So, kind of an eerie image, but, oh, there's a deer. So there is some wildlife. I told you it was a refuge. So the Silver Bridge tragedy has shaped the trajectory of this town and community. It is, to date, the worst bridge disaster in U.S. history. And I'll show you a little bit later when we get back to town where the Silver Bridge once was. It's not where the Green Bridge is right now, but it's closer to where the railroad bridge is. And there's a memorial marking where the bridge, like where you went up into the bridge. And I'll show that when we get back. TNT Area is where you guys were. So we were on this side. I don't know if they have like names, but you were over there. We're over here. And that tour takes you through, and I'm hoping it's the same. They do the same thing. There are more aqueducts over on this side. So you would, an aqueduct is a little, not little, they're big. A structure that you could pull rail cars under, and they would dump hazardous waste, and then they rail it back out. And that tour goes, the hayride goes, like, weaves your way through all the aqueducts. It's really cool. Did you guys spot Mothman last night? A bunch of Mothmen? A bunch of moths. Last night, Terry hit a moth. I told him he killed our only chance of ever seeing him. Moth flew right through the window. He smudged him. He's gone. Yep. He does not have any guts to do that again. That's hilarious. So up here on the right is actually where the North Power Plant once stood. It's actually where the current Mason County Fairgrounds are located. So we're going to point out to you, it has since been demolished, so we're going to point out the general area in which it stood. It was demolished in 1996. They were having problems with vandalism, trespassing, so it was, the structure was no longer being used, so they just went ahead and tore it down. Oh, another fun fact. If you guys are ever in the TNT area at night and you get lost, see these smokestacks straight ahead? They actually have lights on them that come on at night, and they're kind of interesting whoever designed them, but they are two red flashing lights that are on the smokestack. So if you ever get lost, we've been telling people that Mothman will lead you home. Just look for his eyes. on our left is the Mesa County Farm Museum. That's where the tours are held last night. That's also another really cool area to explore, the TNT area. I'm not sure if it's, if you can get in there, but if you want to try, go for it. I know last night during the tours they can get in. So over here on our right, you see the stage with the West Virginia painted on it. A couple hundred feet behind that into the trees is where the North power plant stood. So that's where Linda, Rogers, Mary, and Steve first saw Mothman. They came down this road and booked it this way out to the main road and took a left. On our way back, we're going to talk about some history of Point Pleasant and some other supernatural ideas that Elmer and I both have and feel for Mothman. So, first of all, before we can even, now we've talked about Mothman, we've talked about the TNT area, let's talk about the history of Point Pleasant and how it came to be and how there might actually be a curse on this land. So, on October 10th, 1774, there was a famous battle, Point Pleasant, but before we can talk about that, we have to talk about who inhabited this land before that. Does anyone know who Chief... It was the Native Americans. It was, does anyone know who Chief Cornstalk is? No? Chief Cornstalk was a Shawnee chief, and his tribe lived in the area of Point Pleasant. I don't believe it was called Point Pleasant at the time, but they inhabited this land. In October 10th, 1774, there was a battle for ownership of that land. And during this battle, it's called the Battle of Point Pleasant, which I'm going to tell you guys a final little story as to why I think it's called Point Pleasant. If someone came in and they're like, hey, like, we want that land. Look at that point. It's very pleasant. We should just take it. So, no sympathy laughs. Yeah. So there was a battle, and in that battle, Chief Cornstalk did perish. He was shot. Some people believe, and by some people, I mean me, believe that possibly the shots that killed Chief Cornstalk could have been, and may have been, the first shots of the American Revolution. We're going to believe that. So Chief Cornstalk perished, and it is believed that in his dying breath, he placed a 200-year curse on this land. Someone asked me last night what that curse was, and no one really knows exactly what he said, but we know it was a curse, or we believe it was a curse. So Chief Cornstalk died, and his burial was originally under where the courthouse is. It's where we got on the bus today, so the big brick building, or not brick, but stone building behind the bus. They ended up moving his burial spot due to some poltergeisty type things that were happening at the courthouse. The final straw was a man came in with dynamite strapped to him, and he said the Cornstalk was telling him to do it, go into the courthouse, blow it up. So they figured they should just probably nip that in the bud and move Cornstalk's burial. I've heard two different stories as to where his burial now is, or where his official burial is. One is on Cornstalk Road off of Highway 35. Another is in Tewendowee, which is a park in Point Pleasant, right at the point where the Battle of Point Pleasant happened. And there is a memorial / tomb there. And apparently one of the markers says, here lies the bones of Chief Cornstalk in this tomb. So no one can really crack open that tomb and find out for sure if that is where his bones lay. But you can visit either of those places and read about Chief Cornstalk. Tewendowee is a park in downtown Point Pleasant. There's a lot of history and a lot of information about the settlement of Point Pleasant and how it came to be today.
Now, after the last Mothman sighting in this area, a lot of people just think it just kind of died out, but really it didn't. John Keel had a theory that he came up with, and it kind of suits the situation at hand. He actually talked about it being a doorway to other dimensions. And if you think about the Bermuda Triangle, the Bridgewater Triangle, we have our own little triangle up here. We're actually connected with Parkersburg, West Virginia, and Athens, Ohio. Athens, Ohio was founded by the spiritualist movement in the early 1900s. And obviously Parkersburg is actually buried on top of Parkersburg. So a lot of different stuff has happened through the years. About 30-some years, there's actually two Dogman sightings up here. First one was 1981. when a farmer walked outside and actually saw four big giant dog-like creatures circling his horse, and one broke off as the other three distracted it, jumps up, grabs it by its neck, and pulls it down and kills it. As soon as the creature, you know, does this, he pulls out a shotgun and kills the creature. The other three run off, but he got the, you know, he had the trophy right there pretty much. He did call the authorities, they came out and picked it up. The Point Pleasant, I think it's Gazette, actually has a picture of it in the archives of this paw, and it's actually the size of a bear's paw. Another instance was actually last January. There was actually a sighting back on one of the on the railroad tracks where a woman looked outside. She was getting a drink of water and saw a creature on its hind quarters walking down the road. Another, you know, other stuff that's been going on in the area, you know, Bigfoot sightings, obviously, UFO sightings is always going on. And also, you know, we've had the Low Hotel, there's been poltergeist activity in some of the areas there. Has anybody ever seen the movie Dark Harvest? It's a indie movie that actually was filmed up here in Point Pleasant. It's actually pretty cool. If you ever, I don't know if it's on Netflix or not, look it up. It's actually about a house, I can't disclose where it's at, but it was a house that had a bunch of people murdered in it, and it's very active. I've personally been there, and it creeps me out. So there's a bunch of different stuff that's going on still to this day around Point Pleasant.
So whether we like it or not, Mothman has brought a lot of notoriety and a lot of attention to our small little community. Mothman has created loads of tourism. I'm not sure how many of you are from Point Pleasant. I'm assuming a lot of you aren't. So no one's here from Point Pleasant? See, so tourism here has grown immensely. I'm very thankful for that. We do house the world's only Mothman Museum located on Main Street. If you guys haven't been there, I highly encourage you to check it out. There's a lot of information that Elmer and I are telling you, but there's so much more that we cannot fit into this tour. If you want to read about it, there are multiple books, there are tons of documentaries depicting all these eyewitness accounts, and even more. So, and that museum was featured on an episode of Mysteries at the Museum, which is on History Channel. I really like that show. What they do is they pick certain artifacts, and they go into the history and, you know, legend behind them. It's very interesting. Another show that we were featured on, that Mothman was featured on, is Monster Quest, which I know has since been off the air, but has anyone seen the Monster Quest episode of Mothman? Couple people? Anyone? Well, on that episode of Monster Quest, there was an experiment done out in the TNT area. I actually got to be a part of it, and what they did was a paranormal investigator came in, and he cut out different sizes and shapes of Mothman. There's a whole posse of Mothman that he made, and he went out to the TNT area and placed them at different depths within a path. And so we were in the back of vans, and someone was driving us, and whenever we would get close to one of the cutouts, someone would take a flashlight and, like, shine on it for about 5 seconds. And then we had to record and remember how tall we thought the cutout was and how far away we thought it was from where we are, from where we were. So at the end of the experiment, most people's results were inconclusive. I know mine were completely wrong. My eyewitness accounts were all wrong. There were a couple people that did get it right. My sister was one of those people. Unfortunately, she did not make it on the show because she did not prove their theory. So the theory they were trying, or the experiment they were trying to prove, was just in a heightened state of fear or anxiety, do you make accurate judgment? So it was very interesting, very cool to be a part of. And there's been multiple other shows that, and I know documentaries. There's a documentary you can purchase in the museum gift shop. It's called Eyes of the Mothman. I know it's where I get a lot of my information for this tour from. If you guys want a lot more, there's a lot more information about Chief Cornstalk and their original settlement on this land and how that's important to all of these Mothman sightings. There's a lot more information about the Silver Bridge. So if you're interested in that, it's a great documentary to check out. I think you can also buy it on Amazon.
Now, I don't know if anybody had noticed back there after we got out of the TNT area. Did anybody notice the National Guard base back there? Yes. Well, they do war games out in TNT area. So if you do go out there and see them, don't be alarmed, but don't stay around. I will say that. Also, there is some other military stuff that goes on in this area. There is supposedly, well, there's a naval yard on the back roads here that is right past where Subway is, where they say that silicone is back there for making ammunition and all that stuff. But the funny thing is, there's only one railroad track that goes in and nothing to go out. Now, anybody who knows, you have to have one way in, one way out. Not this one. Rumor has it could be a couple things. It could be a FEMA camp, if anybody's familiar with those. Also, it could be a missile silo base for just in case of attacks. But we are close to the White House, so they could, you know, obviously could. It is a no-fly zone. So, you know, something else to think about as we drive through town. There is some hidden spots around here. Now, coming up here in a second, we're actually going to get to see where the Mothman was seen in town. Now, you're thinking right now, did he just say in town? Yes, I am correct. One night, Miss Garbrey had looked outside. It was a cold winter's night, and she looked outside and saw the creature on it, on her roof. Now, you'll actually get to see the house that she was living in at the time when she saw this, and then you'll actually see how she saw it on the roof. Now, she saw the creature, you know, squat down, take its wings, and wrap itself around himself. So that way, you know, he was cold. And she, at this point, she felt sorry for him. Now, if you look right back here behind this go mark, it is that the house with the black roof that has, like, the little two buildings with it, that's where she saw the Mothman at. Now, look how close we are in town. So, this creature did not fear us. We were more afraid of him than we was afraid of it. Well, it was afraid of us more or less than that. You know, he didn't really care if we were scared of him or not. I think he just wanted to hang out or just waited for McDonald's to open up, or, you know. That's what I always do first thing in the morning, so, you know.
So, guys, we are back in town, so our tour is coming to an end. We hope you've enjoyed your time here in Point Pleasant. We hope you're spending the rest of the day. If you are and you want to check out the festival, that everything still is open. Rain or shine, we are here. One thing I would suggest, if you guys do want to check out some creepy stuff, is the naval yard that Elmer was talking about. You can go over there, just make sure you're careful. I know I've explored it and I get a little freaked out, but it's really interesting to just go over there and see exactly what Elmer's talking about. There's a one-way railroad in, but nothing out. And it, everything is piled up in such a way that you can't really see what's going on. So if you like government conspiracy, I highly encourage you to check that out. I believe the Mountain Monsters men are still here today. There was a very long line to see them yesterday. If you hop in line now, you might be able to see them now. They're a hoot. They look like so much fun. So go see if you can meet them. The world's only Mothman Museum is open all day. If you guys haven't been there yet, please take your ticket that you got for this and you can get in for free. I think a lot of people did that yesterday with the tickets. So if you haven't, remember that you can do that. If you're looking for some good food, we do have Mothman pancakes. Has anyone ever had one? No? Yeah, so the fact that you've had one, they are very good. They're exactly what they sound like. They're pancake shaped just like Mothman. So if you want a little... want some cute food, that's something good to do. There's also, like I said earlier, Tuendawi is going to be all the way down at the end of the festival, right on like the corner of the river. There's a museum, there's a little cabin museum down there, as well as the memorial about Chief Cornstalk that I was referring to. We also have a river museum, talks about boats and barges on the river and how they transport different things using the Ohio River. I'll also point out the Silver Bridge Memorial that I was talking about earlier that shows where the original bridge, where you went up into the bridge to go over to Ohio. But other than that, we've really enjoyed our tour with you guys. If you have any questions, feel free to ask us on the way out, or we'll hang out for a little bit outside. It doesn't look like it's really raining anymore. We do have a tip jar up here. If you felt like we did a great job, you can tip us. We'll allow it. If not, we'll just take words of advice and compliments. Other than that, we hope you guys have had a great day. Be sure to grab all of your things. Take small children and your husbands by the hand. We don't want them to get lost. And we will see you guys very soon. This is the last day of the festival, so if there's anything you have not seen, you have to see it today. It looks like the Hillbilly Zipline is up and going. So if you guys were worried about that, there it is. You're not going to miss it.